Welcome, welcome, welcome. What a great day. Welcome from the front lines of this tremendous struggle, reporting from the front lines here. And today is a great day, really, and I'll explain why. Because today is the day that passed a deadline. And what I did was I refused to do what the ego had pressured me to do. And it's planned for me. You see, and the ego threatened me so severely, saying, if you don't do this, you're going to totally fail. And it put the most incredible pressure on me. Incredible pressure on me to accomplish something. And my situation seems like it's one of absolutely drastic failure. And the ego said, if you do this, you'll succeed. Actually, if I had done that, I would have helped the ego in its advance its plans of failure, even though those plans can never bear any fruit at all. It can seem as though the plans are advancing. The illusion of an advance can be heightened, for sure. So I was able to refuse to do what the ego had pressured me to do. And sometimes it's what you don't do that is the most important. So this certainly displeased the ego greatly, because I was just under this incredible pressure and threats and everything. I had to do something. I said, no, I'm not going to do it. And the ego said, no, you will. You cannot. It's impossible. You won't be able to resist. And I did. Thanks to the help of our brother in Christ, Jesus, who has given very good advice to the world. And I heeded the advice, and the advice is something that sometimes doesn't seem to make a lot of sense, but I just have faith in it. Have faith in it, and there is reason to it. It just we're not so clear about what it is. And what Jesus says is if you can get to the point where you say, "I do not know, I do not know, I do not know what anything is for. There is nothing in this world that I want. There is nothing in this world that I know." I can even say, I don't even know this world at all. I don't know any world. I don't know any place. I don't know anything. I do not know anything. This is actually, all these are statements of freedom from time, from the delusion of time. Because actually, to know something, the way that we talk about it, is to believe that we know it's what it's going to be in the future. And that means that moments are not free and clear. It means we're not free to choose something, choose differently in the future. That the past determines the future. So to say that we know anything means that we're deluded and believing in time. So what he advised to say is to say, I do not know. I do not know. And he says, if you can say that without fear, then you are truly on the brink, on the doors opening to the vision of oneness. And so this morning I say, I'm able to do that. So that's a very, very, it was either do that or do the ego's bidding. And so I was able to, and I was able to avoid a deadline, and we'll see how it goes forward. I'm going to keep pushing forward here. Doing what the Holy Spirit wants is, I do not know. I do not know what this plan is for. I do not know what this tree is for. I do not know what this space is for. I do not know this plant. I do not know this tree. I do not know anything. I don't know anything. I don't know it. I don't know this place. There is no place. I don't know any place. Because to say that we know something, some value, means we believe that value automatically is going to continue on, independent of us deciding to experience some other content. Which means that we think time and process is real, even though it is not. So the statement of freedom is to say, I do not know is a statement of freedom, actually. I do not know is a statement of freedom. Now, this is like the toughest teaching, well, at least certainly up among the most difficult, but somehow in my spirit I'm accepting it, and I'm saying, you know what, that's valid. but it flies in the face of everything that we think we know, right? We think we know everything, meaning we think there's process everywhere, and we've identified the process. We say, sure, I know this world, I know this universe, this world, this place, these trees, this vegetation, this landmass. I know everything. Instead, we just say, I don't know anything. I don't know anything. Meaning, nothing is bound by time. There is no moment that is bound by anything that arises in it to everything that arises. It is all in the moment. It doesn't relate to some other moment. It relates to the totality of that moment. Each moment is a totality. So there's only totality each and every moment. In each and every moment, the freedom to choose our experiencing each and every moment is always there. So there's no such thing as we think of as a place. This world is not a world. This world is not a world, actually. There's no such thing as places. There aren't such things as things. Not really. That's an assumption that there are. It's an assumption of time and process, which is simply mistaken. So, like I said, this teaching is, I'm able to accept it. I'm able to accept it, which is a little bit surprising, but very welcome. I do not know. Jesus said, if you can say, I do not know, without fear arising, that's it, you know. That's super, super important. And I'm able to say it, so I do not know. I do not know. I do not know anything. I do not know what anything is for. I do not know. I'm actually feeling very positive vibes about that. I do not know. I do not know. And paradoxically, instead of being stupid, this returns us to true wisdom. It's the saying, I know this, I know, I know, I know, I know. That's stupidity. That's the war against God, actually. The war against reality. Time is the war against reality. The belief in time is the war against reality. It's the attempt to cause a failure of reality. To change reality. So insisting, I do not know. I do not know. What this hedge is for. I do not know this hedge. I do not know this post. I do not know this tree. This tree is free. I do not know this tree. This tree is free. This tree moment is free, is a free moment. This hedge moment is a free moment. This wall, I do not know this wall. This wall moment is a free moment. Every moment is free. I'm not a body. I am free. I am as God created me. The teachings of our brother in Christ Jesus are, you might say, they're very advanced, but I would just say they're very true and seemingly very different than what we would expect. But I'm finding I'm able to accept more and more, accept it, which is great. But we cannot explain how we can accept it except all the work, the tough work, the practice, the tough work, the practice, the practice, the practice. It sort of evaporates our concern bit by bit by bit. Our concern evaporates. So it's a great thing when any of us are able to go along and accept these teachings. Is a very, very helpful. And the ego had something that it was trying to do, which it would have had a superficially helpful It's something that seemed very helpful also. Okay. But I decided, no. Been there, done that. That doesn't work. I'm going to go with this. I do not know. I do not know. And the ego says, that's crazy. What are you talking about? I have no idea what you're talking about. That's nuts. Nobody's going to understand, the ego says. Nobody's going to understand. Well, maybe not directly. But what this opens up is the door to the vision of oneness. It opens up freedom, and everyone understands freedom, which is a feeling. Everyone understands happiness, and happiness is the feeling of freedom. And we get the feeling of happiness by freeing ourselves from our knowing of things, of presumed time, of process, a presumed process, of this dream of failure. When we realize that we're free and we are as God created us, then the happiness is there. Happiness is the condition of freedom. And so we all can relate to that. So people can, everyone can relate on the level of happiness and freedom. They may not be able to relate in a academic, intellectual way to the teachings so well. And nobody would expect that, actually. Because it does take a lot of discipline and practice, as we have been doing here, as you've seen. So we're able to stay calm, stay patient, stay humble, stay repentant, and simply say, okay, let us simply practice this. And be in the mood of a breakthrough. Be in the mood of breakthrough. Be in the mood to absorb an enormous breakthrough, because the fear we have is actually the fear of our own happiness. That is the fear we have. And so as we practice rehearsing for huge breakthroughs, this is what actually helps us. Even though the breakthrough may not happen, it's not going to happen until we have rehearsed and are ready for it. And then we will be able to say, yes, I don't know anything, and say, ah, that is great. This is freedom. This is freedom. And we're ready to allow the happiness to well up, to saturate us. Very interesting, isn't it? Our fear is based on our fear of our own happiness is what our real fear is. And we try to twist the happiness towards process and things, thinking that it'll protect us from true happiness. But it's just the opposite. I do not know, and therefore I am happy. I do not know anything, therefore I am happy. And I do not know what anything is for. Right? I do not know anything. I do not know what anything is for. This world has nothing that I want. I do not know anything in this world. I do not know what anything is for in this world, and therefore I'm happy. Because it's a statement of my freedom. So the ability to get to this, I do not know, I believe, is based on the spiritual exercises that we've been doing here, which is to rehearse our happiness. Rehearse our happiness. The massive, colossal, immense, stupendous mountain of gold, of shimmering, scintillating, sparkling, radiant, glowing, splendid, exquisite gold, a mountain. And this represents the happiness of our freedom from the crazy whim of trying to change reality, and therefore believing in time-space, and believing in process, and believing in becoming, and believing in failure, believing that success, that failure equals success. Where the alternative to that is setting that down, our happiness will be there. So we have to rehearse our happiness. This is how I believe I've gotten to where I am right now, is rehearsing the happiness, even though there's not been any direct happiness. I haven't felt any. But I'm able to now accept the practice of, I don't know anything. I don't know. I truly do. I do not know anything. And instead of a fear, saying that fearfully with trepidation, I'm saying it happily, or at least confidently, without fear. Like a yes, I don't know anything. Yes, that's great. Because when we do it that way, this will lead to happiness, actually. That great golden mountain of happiness. Of course, the ego is going to say we're absolutely nuts. What else can it say? Because again, the ego believes that failure is success. And what we're doing is we're actually dropping failure. So in the ego's belief system, we're dropping success, according to the ego. When the ego says that must be crazy, you're claiming success and yet you're dropping it. And we say, no, we are claiming success because we're dropping failure, the effort towards failure. That's why we're claiming success. We're claiming success because we're accepting our true nature of freedom and happiness. That's success, actually. So again, oftentimes, the best way to help the world can be to not do something, a project the ego wants you to do, is to not do it, because the ego counts on you. The ego was counting on me, put this god-awful pressure on me. You know, it just, like I'm on the edge of destitution. Worse than that, other people depending on me, also on the edge of destitution. All the pressure designed to get me to do something for the ego. And I said, no, no. And the ego couldn't believe that I said no. I said, look, all these people depend on you. The whole situation is going to collapse. You're going to cause the deaths of other people. You're just like the craziest, most selfish person in the world. You get this kind of pressure, right? It's just like, how can you possibly do that? You know, you must be insane. You must be evil. You must, the ego puts all this pressure on you. I said, well, I'm not going to do it. And the ego says, no, you will. It's impossible for you not to. And he keeps talking you that way. And I say, no, not going to do it. You wait and see. See, the ego wants to keep us bound to time. And if we say we don't like the future, the ego says, well, great, then you can go dwell in the past. Dwelling in the past is like the ego says, that's better, I understand that. That's spiritual, dwell in the past. So pick something from the past that's really wonderful and then try to wrap your whole life around that, something from the past, if you don't like the future. But what we're saying is, no, time is an illusion. We're going to choose our present happiness that's always present, based on our always present freedom from all time. Past future is one concept arising in the moment, in one moment, not multiple not linked to other moments. We could choose another moment with the same concept, but it's not one moment has the past and one moment has the future. No, each moment has the past future if we're wanting to entertain the whim of time. Now, all of this may just not be cohesive for the understanding of anyone, but the gist of it is, I was able to refuse to do what the ego was sure it could pressure me into doing. This really actually causes a lot of troubles for the ego. A lot of troubles, because it now doesn't really have an alternative. It can't point to something in time and say, hey, you don't like time? Here's something in the past. Here's something you can do that is still keeping you in the delusion of time. And so it's stuck with this future that people are saying, I hate this. You know, this is terrible. So it puts the pressure on the ego, you see. It puts pressure because people are saying, wow, you know, what do we do? What do we do? What do we do? And the ego doesn't have this scenario that I was hoping to produce, trying to pressure me into producing it. And so now people will be more likely to truly listen to the teachings of Jesus, the teachings of the great teachers. And in my instance right now, going with the teachings of Jesus as far as in relating to time, the non-existence of time is a delusion. It's a whimsical wish. In time, so let's see if we can set time down, set failure down. Of course, the idea of failure requires time space, doesn't it? In order for something to fail, there has to be two something, and then the failure of that something. And it has to be seen as a failure rather than a choice of a different moment. See, if you just choose a different moment, that moment is a totality, and there's no failure of that moment at all. So where can the failure occur? There's no failure in any moment. The failure, we think, can only occur when one moment somehow fails to be total, which is impossible. So time is really impossible, but we have this illusion that one moment with the past and one moment with the future, that somehow the past made that next moment, had to be the way it is based on the other moment. You see what I'm saying there? That moments, there's some sort of cause and effect between moments. And Jesus says there is no cause and effect between moments, none whatsoever. So we cannot know the cause and effect, can we? Because there isn't any. So when I say I do not know anything, meaning I do not know any cause and effect between moments. Therefore, I do not know time, time-space. Because that refers to causation between, cause and effect between moments, and the witnessing to that. The belief that this is taking place. So if we say, I don't know anything, I don't know anything at all. I don't know any cause whatsoever. There is no cause taking place, cause and effect taking place. This is a statement of reality, a statement of freedom. See, our happiness is uncaused. It's not coming from supposed cause and effect between moments. That's where we're looking for it. Where we say looking for love in all the wrong places. We're looking for happiness in all the wrong places, which is the presumption that there is moments have cause and effect between other moments. They're influencing, they have influence, and we believe that this is where we need to look for our happiness. And so we keep choosing moments to make it seem like the past is influencing the future moments, future. And then trying to be happy from this moment we're choosing, from the feeling of the cause and effect and influence, looking for happiness there. And of course, all we find is fear of an abyss. And the happiness that is always present seems to be the abyss to us now. And the actual abyss of not having any cause and effect there, which isn't really an abyss, but in our belief system, it seems to be. We cling to things and processes and belief that there is cause and effect. And again, all of this seems too much to understand, but there is understanding here. So it's not too much. It is not too much. It has to do with our fear, a continuity fear. When we lessen the continuity fear, then all of this stuff that seems like mumbo jumbo, we're able to understand it. Able to understand it. Able to say, oh yeah, I appreciate it. I can see that. I appreciate it. This is pointing to my true happiness. But if the way to understand is to lessen the continuity fear. which means lessen the fear of happiness. So to get to the exercises to lessen the fear of happiness, first we have to work on the continuity problem, which I said that's the first practice everyone has to do, to say, I don't have any other problem, I just have one problem. See, that centers you in just this one problem, and then you say, okay, but what's the answer to this one problem? My only problem is the continuity fear. Continuity problem is the only problem I have. If we don't do that, the ego will have us chasing after rainbows and say, well, the problem here is you're not happy because this cause and effect is not what you want. You need to alter the cause and effect. So we'll have you working on cause and effect between moments forever, telling you that the reason you're feeling unhappy and fearful is that. No, the reason we're feeling unhappy and fearful is we have a continuity problem with happiness, with true happiness. So when we take away the ego's narrative of telling us where to work, and we say, no, I'm only going to work on the continuity problem, then we're able to do these exercises, rehearsing for happiness, happiness rehearsal. And once we do that, then we're able to get to this time situation of moments and cause and effect, non-existent cause and effect. We're able to get to that and say, I don't know anything. I don't know anything. I don't know any cause and effect between moments. There isn't any, so I don't know. I don't know anything. I don't know this tree. I don't know this walkway. I don't know the sky. I don't know this world at all. I don't know anything. I don't know. I don't know. There is no cause and effect between moments. So what the ego tells us is that we've been focused on believing there is, and that's knowledge. We think that's knowledge. There isn't any such knowledge. So to say, I don't know, is a declaration of freedom. So first the continuity problem, we work and we become expert at that. Then happiness rehearsal. I am, you know, this exquisite, blissful, peaceful. And then that gets us to be able to say, I don't know. And then the door is open. This is how I see it progressing properly. And I did say that the continuity problem was the very root practice, that without that, you wouldn't be able to focus in effectively on the happiness rehearsals. And I see it that way, definitely. Otherwise, the ego will just drag your mind away. And you think, oh, I got to be working on these other problems. And you say, no, there isn't any other problem. I don't have any other problem. I only have a continuity problem. There is no other problem. This is really the root practice. And then from that comes the happiness rehearsal. So have it very much streamlined right now. Very much streamlined. And paradoxically, what people are terrified of and thinking they need to get more and more knowledge so they can get rid of this fear is the fear of our own happiness. And that fear, the happiness will never go away. Our happiness is based on our freedom. Our freedom will never go away. So the more we work to gain knowledge to defend against this fear, the more fearful we become, actually. Because the more continuity problem we have, because we keep thinking there's cause and effect between moments, even more cause and effect. And therefore, we feel even more isolated from our happiness. Happiness seems to even be a greater abyss because we have more knowledge to lose. We think, oh my God, I feel like someone's trying to take all my knowledge away from me. So the more knowledge we get of cause and effect between moments, presumed, the more fearful we become of our happiness and our freedom. So it's a vicious circle there. One of the greatest realizations is that our fear comes from our own happiness. We think it's an abyss. We lose all our knowledge and fall into an abyss of not knowing anything. Well, there's nothing to know. I mean, reality is. It's not a question of knowing it. Well, from our stand, as far as time-based knowledge, all right, reality is, it's intrinsically known. Without a knower, there's no knower of reality. Reality is a totality. Everything knows everything. There's not some other knower. And certainly there's not knowledge about cause and effect between moments. There's no such knowledge. So we're pursuing a false knowledge, let's put it that way, a false knowledge, a false knowing. And we think that without it, we'll be in, fall into an abyss. No, without it, happiness, we'll realize happiness is everywhere. That's what we'll realize. There's only happiness. It's our believed in knowledge of the failure of happiness, which is the issue, right? So the more knowledge we get, the more we think we know, the more we think we know, the more we think we know, the more fearful we become of our own happiness, of our own freedom. And therefore, the more we desperately pursue more that we think we know, more that we think we know. We need to just keep on measuring and collecting data and calculating and judging and thinking to try to protect ourselves from what we think is an abyss. It's the loss of all that knowledge. It's the loss of nothing. Oh, so again, even though we cannot seem to get the knowledge of what's being said here, we don't need to get the knowledge. In other words, how do we put that into so we can think we know about what's being said? We're not trying to think we know about what's being said. We're feeling and intuiting deep down what's being said and accepting it, saying, yeah. And then just abiding with that in the mood of repentance, like, wow. Just this wow feeling, like, wow. Don't have to think we know about what's being said. Because the whole thing is, we're saying we don't think we know anything. Anything we think we know, we don't know. There isn't anything to know. True knowing is never based on our thinking and our thoughts. Because true knowing is to know that moments do not influence other moments. That's true knowledge. So this kind of information is very stunning at some level. It's stunning. It's also a feeling like, wow, maybe I can really be happy after all. It'll be a great surprise to me, because I really felt for a long time that happiness was totally impossible for me. I would never, ever be happy again, you know, and gone forever. So, should it return, that would be very interesting. It's like, wow, very stunning. Which is why we need to rehearse for it, actually. The happiness that we think we're getting from what we think we know is just attractive forms of fear. That's all it is, attractive forms of fear. It's not real happiness at all. Our true happiness is unalloyed, non-reactive, a lot of qualities we've rehearsed in our practice videos. It just is. And so we have a continuity issue with this, which is why rehearsals are very important. To think along the lines of what I'm experiencing, what I'm feeling is this massive, immense, colossal mountain of, you know, pure gold, just this golden mountain. This immense, wide open, never-ending mountain of gold. It's our happiness, this golden happiness. Golden happiness. Unalloyed. Process-free, location-free, time-free, space-free. course, this, we're not accustomed to this. We keep thinking, you know, attractive forms of fear. Where's the attractive form of fear? You know, where's a body? Where's a form? I need to attach my happiness to some form, whatever it is. This is a formless happiness. This is a happiness that is here regardless of any appearances whatsoever. Free of anything that we think we know. Free of any notion of being bound by cause and effect between moments. Entirely free of all that. So this does require some practice, rehearsing. Don't bet on it just happening without any rehearsal or whatsoever. It's feasible it could happen. There's some who may have done that rehearsal in previous lives, and then they just there it is for them. Don't bank on that. The ego wants you to bank on that, actually. Because we have a vast continuity problem. Vast continuity problem. So for everyone, almost without exception, rehearsal is mandatory. Mandatory. Because the only happiness there is this process-free, location-free, baseless, traceless, colossal, immense, stupendous mountain, wide open, endless mountain of gold, totally untouched by time, space. This is the only true happiness that there is. It's the only happiness there is. So, you know, we have to rehearse for that. Have to rehearse for that. That's why Jesus says, as much as you can, say this, as much as you can. And it makes a big, big deal about every hour, you know, try to say every hour, all throughout the day, practice, practice, practice. Again, almost without any exception, everyone has to practice, 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 rehearse, rehearse. And what about the incredibly infinitesimal one that doesn't seem to practice so much? The happiness they experience is exactly the same as the happiness we will experience of the ones who do rehearse. Okay. So there's no difference at all. So, but almost without exception, all of us have to take this way of right spiritual practice, right spiritual effort. Don't just sit back and watch television and think, oh, it's going to happen for me. You know, if it's that easy, it should happen. It doesn't work that way. We have a continuity problem. So those who admit, you know, I have a severe continuity problem, I've been so accustomed to chasing after attractive forms of fear, thinking that's happiness, that I really don't know what true happiness is at all. And I feel I might just, it's almost like going into an abyss of I don't know what it's like. You know, I'm not timeless, you know, process-free, traceless, baseless. What is this? So there's a continuity issue. If we don't practice, we'll continue to go after attractive forms of fear, for sure, for sure. Even though they may be very attractive forms, they're still forms. And forms are fear-based. All forms are fear-based. Thinking that we know a form is fear-based. Thinking that we know a form is fear-based. Because we're saying there's cause and effect between moments. And there isn't. So the belief there's cause and effect between moments is to believe in an abyss. Is to believe in an abyss. And to believe that you dwell in an abyss. And so we've been clutching all these attractive forms of fear, thinking that protects us from the abyss. We think if we give them up, we'll fall in the abyss. No, if we give it up, we'll realize there is no abyss. There's never been an abyss. There's only happiness. And yet we're not ready for the happiness. So you can see this kind of entanglement, but it's not that tricky as we think it might be. It's not tricky at all. We simply admit we have a severe continuity problem. That's the only problem we have. And then we rehearse for happiness. That simple. It's that simple. We're in the month of May. Fifth month of the year. And it's great to be here. Great to be here. Great to be surmounting the obstacles. And we have a lot of hope. A lot of hope now for the rest of the year. We've gotten through one third of this year, haven't we? January, February, March, and April. 4 months is one third of the year. So the year's already one third passed. Now we're into the second third of this year. You might call it the middle part of the year, actually. And not only are we standing with I Am, I stand with I Am. But we're getting tremendous hindsight, clarity in hindsight, saying, ah, I see what works. Now we've seen what works, where we're going. And without some super fantastic, attractive form of fear, which what the ego was trying to get me to do, because it knew I was capable of doing that, of producing some incredibly attractive form of fear for people to grab a hold of and turn to the past, thinking that holding on to some attractive form of fear in the past, it will protect us from attractive forms of fear in the future. Not only do we don't have that, because I didn't do it, but we have this clarity about what does work. So we're in a good spot, actually. Very good spot. Very good situation. So time to celebrate that fact. Tremendous help. I thank God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit for all the help. The right advice, the right help, the right counseling. Hate for this video to end. I'd rather just keep on taping all day. Because what do I do next? Yeah, this is keeping attention, keeping our eye on the prize here. Keeping our eye on the prize. So I had to make a choice. Can't do both. Can't do both. I realize that. You cannot do both. You cannot serve two masters. You cannot go all in on attractive form of the past, attractive form of fear to cling to, whatever form it may be. And at the same time, go all in towards awakening to our true happiness, which is really free of what we think we know as form. Because what we think we know as form is not true. We don't know anything. We really don't know anything. Can't go all in both ways. You cannot serve two masters. If you try to do, you'll be faithful to neither one. You'll just, you know, you'll fail in both ways. And so I had to decide. Which way to go. Now, it's kind of scary because it does feel, you're like, wow, maybe there's, you know, maybe I'll fail, maybe there'll be an abyss, or maybe it's like, wow, it's very, very intense. But for me, it's just the edge, it's just sort of a, edge of glow, afterglow of intensity. It's not really that intense at this point. But in hindsight, I'll look back on it in hindsight and say, wow, what a great decision. But right now, I'm kind of like saying, oh, wow. You know, in making a choice, it seems to be tough. At the crossroads, you stand at the crossroads, which way to go? You know, it's like, wow, can't go both ways. So I decided the journey to true happiness, drop time, and to keep on this way that we're going here, and not to veer off of that. So that's great, very great, very, very great. This is the time to make the push, to reassure the world. This is the time to stand up, reassure the world. This is the time to move past the crossroads. So today is that day of going down this road now. We've made a decision. We're moving past the crossroads, going forward. And again, thank you, our brother Jesus in Christ, who happens to know the truth of all of this and has told us all of this in recent teachings and ancient teachings and more recent teachings. Because this is information that if we didn't get it in a very loving way, we would very much would retreat and withdraw from it and search for attractive forms of fear that we think can make us happy. Search for some moments in time we think where the cause and effect, imaginary cause and effect, was better, you know. But fortunately, we have this teaching. It's just so like, wow, are you sure? Really? Wow. But the love and compassion that comes from the teaching, you realize, you know, it's, you say, okay, I'm gonna go forward with this. Even though there's some trepidation, like, but just a little, you know, we've worn it off. A lot has evaporated. So just keep on doing what we're doing. Okay, very great. That's it for this video.